So today, therefore, just as you caused a change in yourself in financial sacrifices, I draw your attention to the observance of prayers, worship, and other righteous deeds, and urge you to try to march forward towards betterment. I hope and pray that Allah the Almighty will enrich you with the blessings of this Jalsa, and that you will make progress in your spiritual conditions. For the strengthening of your faith, you will keep the commandment of Allah in front of you, in which Allah the Almighty says, وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ. And as for those who believe, they are the foremost in their love for Allah. The love of Allah will never drive you away from worship. You will always rank amongst the believers about whom God Almighty says that when they are called to determine a matter, their response is, Samina wa atana, we hear and we obey. It is not that we will accept those matters that are in accord with our wishes and reject those that go against our desires. I hope those among you who have shown such an attitude will bring about a positive change for the sake of strengthening their faith. I have highlighted some signs of the believers. May Allah enable you to ponder over their intricacies and continue to enlighten your faith so that you keep on receiving divine bounties and grace. Allah the Almighty has promised Khilafat to those who progress in their beliefs and to the ones who perform good deeds as well. What are good and righteous deeds, and why are they integral to belief? In this connection, you have already heard the explanation of the Prophet Messiah al-Islam. Amongst the deeds that have been mentioned by the Prophet Messiah al-Islam, I elaborate further so that everyone can assess themselves, because these are such matters that can consume their righteous deeds. And as I had said in my Khilafat Jubilee address, the worship of such people confers no benefit to them. The Prophet Messiah al-Islam says, righteous deeds are those in which there is no cruelty. In the Holy Quran, Allah the Almighty has presented several examples of cruelties, some of which I present here. In connection with matters related to ladies, when marriage ends on the rocks and divorce is considered, do not delay the matter beyond the waiting period. There are only two options: either terminate it finally in divorce or bring about reconciliation in an appropriate manner and put a stop to that matter. Also, do not end the matter just to cause difficulties or to aggravate the situation. If you do this, it will be cruelty. You make this that you are only causing difficulty to a woman, but this will be a grave mistake on your part. Allah the Almighty says, وَمَنْ يَفَلْ ذَلِكَ فَقَدْ ظَلَمَ نَفْسَ. And whoso does that surely wrongs his own soul. You are thinking that by causing cruelty and aggravation, you are disturbing only her. But do you not know that in fact by inviting Allah's displeasure, you are causing cruelty to yourself? Thus, if indeed they have the fear of God, men should pay attention to discharging the rights of women. Then Allah the Almighty says at another place that those who usurp the rights of others by eloquent speeches also commit cruelty. And Allah the Almighty punishes the cruel and the oppressors because of their transgression. Allah the Almighty has advised the believers to perform good deeds. Therefore, those who engage in such conduct that is against the commandments of God will be counted amongst the tyrants. So each Ahmadi should assess himself. Complaints are received about cruelties in the relationships between husband and wife. Neither do they comply with the administration of the Jamaat, nor do they listen to the Khalifa of the time. Then when they are punished because of these cruelties, they say that they have been treated unfairly. Although in reality, they have been unfair to themselves. This issue is so alarming sometimes. This is why I have been repeating it here. Then in lending and borrowing and in big ticket business transactions, people usurp the rights of each other. They think that they have made a fool of the other party. They fail to understand that according to Allah the Almighty, they are only ingesting fire by destroying the peace in society. They are earning the displeasure of Allah the Almighty. Thus, being in such a condition, they belong neither to the faith nor to the world. In this connection, every Ahmadi should continue to assess himself. If on the one hand we shout slogans of peace and security, how can we, on the other hand, become the destroyer of the peace in society? Instead of spreading peace, how can we cause people agony and pain? Then the Prophet Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam says that one should stay away from self-pride and conceit, because it is such a disease where the person is so self-centered that he pays no importance to the opinion of others, nor does he pay any respect or reverence to others. It is a thing that leads to arrogance. When this disease occurs in society, it prevents one from discharging the rights of others. And as a result, it opens ways for disorders. Allah the Almighty says in the Holy Quran, وَلَا تُسَاعِرْ خَدَّكَ لِلنَّاسِ وَلَا تَمْشِ فِي الْأَرْضِ مَرَحًا إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ كُلَّ مُخْتَالٍ فَخُورٍ. And turn not the cheek away from men in pride, nor walk in the earth haughtily. Surely Allah loves not any arrogant boaster. Thus, it is clear that the boaster and the proud are arrogant, and that is something greatly disliked by Allah the Almighty. The Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, do not disdain doing the least good, even though it be greeting your brother with a cheerful face. In another